that is, I don't have any answers. That's my get out clause. But what I think we can do together tonight is revisit the scriptures to see what the scriptures do say and to see where the rest of it is speculation. We can also look at what the speculations might lead to, what the options might be. Let me start, and of course, I did say in the flyer, I don't know whether you've read the flyer, that we were going to examine this question of the tribulation and the rapture. And we were going to look at three positions during the course of this search. We're going to look at the pre-rapture idea, the pre-trib idea, just testing, the mid-trib idea, and the post-trib idea. I'd just like to take a straw poll. Do any of you hold a position on pre-trib? Just show of hands. I just want to do a rough... one, two, three, four...
I don't know what pre-trib means.
Sorry. Well, don't worry. If you don't know, then that's fine. You don't hold that position if you don't know. Probably. How many might have a mid-trib position? One, two, three...
Ish.
Four, five. It's not much different. And how many might have a post-trib position? None. And how many have are they not got one way or the other?
I've got a post-mantis.
Yeah, okay, fair enough. It might be worth me preceding this by saying that there's a great deal of confusion over this. It's an avoided subject. People get hot under the collar about it. Now, there's something wrong when people get hot under the collar about something like this. Just consider what I'm saying. There's a spiritual problem if people get hot under the collar about these options. So we can be sure, when we look at the difficulties it causes, churches won't preach it because it's troublesome, and because they say, well, there is no real answer. The churches that do preach it are in America, and they preach the pre-trib position. And many people, because it's all we hear, many people latch onto that and say, if you bring up the subject, I don't need to know all about end times because I'm going to be taken up anyway, before it all happens. Well, I hope they're right. I want to be in that position, but if they're not right, I want to be sure I'm doing what else needs to be done. I'm living my life right, that the Lord might favour me when the time comes. It isn't that he might favour me, you know what I'm trying to say. So, you know, I think it's a very dangerous position that's been brought upon the church. And the reason that I think it's worthy of examination is because scriptures say so much about it. You know, if there's anything that's fundamental to scripture's points, to the points of the compass in scripture, it's Jesus. He's the whole focus in his first coming and in his second coming. It doesn't start and end with the cross. It starts with the cross and the resurrection. But the resurrection for us is a promised thing that will come upon his return, on his second coming. The Jews have always been confused about this, because looking at the Old Testament, it makes no clarity about two comings of their Messiah. You read it, and you read Isaiah, and wherever you'll find these things, you read scriptures in the Old Testament as though it comes and sorts it all out in one heap. But it also says confusing things like he comes as a lion and he comes like a lamb. That's a bit difficult to join together. Well, of course, he comes first as a lamb. The lamb that was slain, and he comes last as a lion, the Lion of Judah, upon whose shoulders will the authority be. Hallelujah. In between times, in this Christian era, we're being brought up to know him, to increasingly revere him. And I believe that the entry into these difficult scriptures and the pursuit of trying to find out what are you saying, Lord, is healthy, because it makes us search scriptures. It makes us find things out we've missed, even if it's not with the subject. But it focuses ultimately on Jesus. What we're saying is, Lord, when are you coming? I'm loving to know. I want to know, Lord, when are you coming? He said, well, not even the Father knows that, so I can't tell you, he said. More or less, I'm paraphrasing, aren't I? I'm paraphrasing. But it's here for a reason. I believe the scriptures are deliberately vague. And vague isn't actually the right word, I don't think. They're deliberately elusive. I believe the answers are in there, but extremely difficult to apprehend. And the real finality of it will only become clear as we draw very close to his return. When we need to know for the comfort of the age we're in, then the revelation will become clear. I'm convinced of that. That's my belief. But for now, being as we never know because the end comes like a flood, how quickly this might come upon us, I believe that it's wise that we understand what we can find out about this subject of our Lord's coming, and especially the times that might be upon the world, and where we might stand in that. So much for a short introduction. And I've got about 2 days seminar to do in the next hour. So it's not really a matter of great depth, but it's a matter of having a good look at what a lot of things that we will already know. I'd like to first of all look at what scriptures do say, what the unequivocal position is. And here's the things that I've chosen to talk through in that regard. First of all, that the Lord is coming. You know, you've got this position that some Christians hold, or some theologians hold, about the historicist, the futurist, and the preterist, and you might not have heard of them. All it means is, the historicist means it all happened at the time it was written. The futurist means it's all written for the end times and times to come. And the preterist means it's all been happening throughout time and some of it's yet got to happen. They're all wrong. Because all of those things are why. It was written concerning the times in which it was written. It was written with an emphasis on the return of the Lord. And it was written for all time. God is unchangeable. Scripture is a pattern. What applied then applies now and will apply. And so all of those positions apply. So we need to argue about that. And given that, let's just examine the fact of Scripture. Acts 1:11 is one of my favourite passages, which says, "Men of Galilee," this was when Jesus was being taken from the earth into the clouds. "Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven." There is nothing ambiguous in that scripture. Peter said about Paul's writing, some things hard to understand, and some are. But there was nothing ambiguous and difficult about that. It says quite clearly that this same Jesus, not a spaceman or another Jesus, not a replacement Jesus, this same Jesus, who you saw taken into heaven, and they were eyewitnesses, will so come in like manner as you saw him go. He was taken in the clouds, he'll return in the clouds. Hallelujah. Praise be to God. Yeah. Not up for grabs. Here's some more things that are not up for grabs about the next coming of Jesus. It comes for the church. Now, I better qualify this before I go any further. I've used this terminology because I don't want this to become the subject tonight. But we have to identify what is the church. If you do a study sometime on who is the bride, you might beg some questions of yourself. Again, just as in America, the pre-trib position's been preached to the exclusion of most others, to the extent even that if anybody goes another direction, they're almost outcast. So is this idea that the church, once saved, always saved, all you've got to do is say yes to Jesus and wait for the big time to come. Well, that's not the way I read scriptures, folks. And Shirley and I are increasingly of the belief that the Lord comes for a remnant of a remnant. I want to be in that remnant. How about you? Now look, if I'm wrong, play safe. Okay? What I'm saying to you shouldn't be challenging. It should quicken the love in your heart for our Lord. It should refresh us and revive us. Hallelujah. So, not all that calls itself church possibly is church. Well, I'm not the only one that said it. Paul and Peter have both met, and Timothy, Timothy talked a lot about it. Apostates. They're like wandering stars in outer darkness forever. Now listen, I don't want to be a tough preacher. I'm just trying to say, let's shake off all of this popular belief that there's no more to Christianity than getting saved. Getting saved is only the beginning of a wonderful, marvellous, challenging walk. A challenge in which we're not alone, because the Lord and His Holy Spirit will direct our paths every step of the way. Hallelujah. When we're in Him, and we love Him, and we're focused on Him, we cannot go wrong. It might look as if we do. It might look to the world as if we do, because the Lord did say we shall have tribulations. But we don't have tribulations that we can't stand, because the Holy Ghost gives us the empowerment to take whatever it is and deal with it, give it to Him. And He works with us. I mean, I've been a dead man, resurrected from the dead. You know, the Lord tests us, but He also strengthens us as we go through it. A tree that's even well-rooted, a tree that has no wind, if serious winds came, would get snapped. It grows strong because it faces the storms. And so it's not meant to be an easy life, but it's meant to be a wonderful life. For there's no life like knowing Jesus. The joy that He gives when we pray and see Him answer. And He does it constantly, doesn't He? Big ways and little ways. So I won't go on. I'm just trying to say, please don't take what I'm saying as being strong stuff. I'm trying to just say, let's not get caught up in the popularity of easy Christianity. After all, anything that's easy isn't worth very much. You think of your own normal, natural life. The challenges that you have, and you get over them and make them really good. You do something and you do it well and you really apply yourself to it. That's when the reward comes. That's when the joy comes of a job well done and an achievement made. That's what drives sportsmen after all. Hallelujah. So let's have a look at these scriptures. 1 Corinthians 15 is a well-known passage. In this respect, taking just a couple of verses, 51 and 52, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. Amen. Hallelujah. So that's not telling us any ambiguous things. It says, well, we shall not all sleep. By the way, you see, when Scripture uses the word sleep, it doesn't mean having a nap overnight. It means that we've passed this mortal coil and awaiting the resurrection. That's what sleep's used for in the New Testament. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, an instant thing. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. And 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 and 17 says, for the Lord Himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with Him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Isn't that lovely? So the Lord Himself will descend with a shout, the voice of an archangel and the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. And then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with Him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we And I'm just trusting that we're in that generation that will be caught up. But then my old spiritual mentor, Danny McVicker, used to reckon he would be. But he passed away a few years ago. You see, ever since the Lord, churches of all at the ages have thought this, that the Lord will come back. We can see all the signs. Now that's not new. It's meant to keep us on our toes. But you know, there are so many things, if we were to look at the signs of the times now, that's different. Most of the things of the end time signs are in place like dominoes. Push one and they go zoom. Okay, unequivocal. Now another thing then that the scriptures tell us is that the Lord will reign for 1,000 years, governing all nations. And it says in Revelation 21 verse 6, blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. That's the one we've been talking about. Over such the second death has no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Isaiah 9:6 says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. Zechariah 14:16, and it shall come to pass that everyone who is left of all the nations which came against Jerusalem shall go up from year to year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. So we'll come back to that later. And then the Lord comes for Israel. So he comes for, I've called it the church, he comes for Israel. It shall be in that day that I will seek to destroy all the nations that come against Jerusalem. And I will pour on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplication. Then they'll look on me whom they pierced. Yes, they'll mourn for him as one who mourns for his only son, and grieve for him as one grieves for a firstborn. Israel, the last shall be first and the first shall be last. They were the first, but they'll be the last in. We were the last, but we're the first in. Revelation 1:7, by the way, that's the remnant again. It leaves a lot of questions. It doesn't answer them all, but the outline of it is very clear. I always say, keep a high-level view. Don't sink into too much detail. Revelation 1:7, behold, he's coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even they who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so. The ones that mourn, of course, will be the ones that have missed it. The second coming of Christ for Israel. Romans 11:25-27. For I do not desire, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own opinion. That blindness in part has happened to Israel, until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And so all Israel will be saved. As it's written, the deliverer will come out of Zion, and he'll turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant with them, when I take away their sins. Now that fullness that I've underlined, some translations speak of the full number of the Gentiles. But if you actually look at Strong's Concordance, the Strong's number, that word is generally used in the Greek. Of course, it's in the Greek. That word was generally used for the preparation of and readiness of a ship to sail, when it was fully prepared. Its preparation, of course, had the full number of crew, but it also had the full provisions for them. It had the cargo and the reasons for its departure and journey. Everything concerned with the journey was ready. And I believe that this fullness of the Gentiles is quite fundamental to our position today. As Gentiles, I believe that the fullness of understanding of God will come upon us. It certainly, I believe, it will come upon a generation before the Lord does return, but I suggest we're getting close to it. One thing that's really quickened my, taken my attention and quickened my spirit, you've heard Pierce speak here, and Pierce was telling us about the work he's doing in Ukraine with Jews coming to the Lord, Jews coming to their Messiah, to Jesus, and also, of course, with the Gentiles out there, the established church coming together, the one new man. But the thing is, he said, these newcomers, these Jews who know the Old Testament, they're challenging the church and say, why do you do that? It isn't in our scriptures. You see, we've got to get out of the fog that's come upon Western Christianity. We've got to start finding out from the Lord, be released into doing church properly, if that's the way I can put it in an oversimplistic term. Because if you look around, it's a mess. I'm sorry, I speak bluntly. Most of you got used to me. And you'll have to forgive me, please. I don't wish to be rude or offensive at all. But I do like to call a spade a shovel. You know, the church isn't in good shape. But God's in good shape. Amen. And if he wanted it to be, at a stroke, it could cause it. And I believe he's bringing it to pass. I believe these little hearings that we hear from Ukraine are the beginning of something important. Hallelujah. The fact that the messianic community, that the Jewish community are finding this, finding the Saviour, coming in amongst the established church and challenging it. And it's not likely to be only in the Ukraine that that's happening. Now, what's the promise, therefore? Promises are to the overcomers. If we read the letters to the churches of Revelation, they all end up with a promise to the overcomers. The promise to the overcomers are everlasting life with a new incorruptible body like Jesus. We just read about it. I think we read about it. To rule and reign with Jesus upon the earth throughout the last millennium, so we come back with him to rule and reign with new bodies. Not flesh and blood, but flesh and bone. We won't go down that. At the end of the millennium, to return to the Father in Jesus, with Jesus within him for eternity. I mean, what a beautiful thought. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to dwell in that city of gold. They even use gold for tarmac, my old mentor used to tell me. Hallelujah. The streets are paved with it. By the way, that's the Shekinah glory. Yeah. That's gold. Yeah. Shirley could tell you a story about that, but that's something else. Now, we as Christians then, where do we stand in all this? Well, this heading says deliverance from God's wrath. Revelation 15:1 says, and I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvellous, seven angels having the seven last plagues, for in them this filled up the wrath of God. So ultimately, the wrath of God is going to be brought upon the earth. But Thessalonians 5:9 says, for God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. That leaves one of two possibilities, maybe more, but two immediately cross my mind as far as Christians are concerned. Either they're taken out of it before the wrath, or they're so covered by his glory that they're somehow insulated from it. But I think when you use any common sense at all and read the scriptures, the being insulated at the very end, I mean, it don't figure very much. Let's read some more. Revelation 20:4-6 speaks of the first resurrection. I saw thrones and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. Then I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and the word of God. Did you read that? The souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and the word of God. We've seen some of them on telly, haven't we?
Yeah.
with ISIS lining them up on the beach. And, and did you notice they were being massacred for their Christian belief and unwillingness to change? And did you notice not one of them broke down or pleaded? See, God, I believe God meets you if you're in this, if you go with God. I believe the Spirit of God gives you a very special something that takes you through it. And it makes no difference, because we're all going to go that way, one way or the other.
Yeah.
It's only the fear of man. And it says the fear of man is a snare.
Yes.
Then I saw the souls of those who had been headed for the witness to Jesus and for the word of God, who had not worshipped the beast or his image, and had not received his mark on their foreheads or on their hands. We've skipped a bit of scripture, of course. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead didn't live again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such the second death has no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Hallelujah. Isaiah says, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Hallelujah. So when will this be? Matthew 24, Jesus, the disciples came to him privately saying, tell us when will these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? In 29, verse 29-31, after giving them much information, he says, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he'll send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they'll gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. Well, that's what scriptures do say. Let's consider it from the other point of view. What do scriptures not say? And I've noted here that scriptures must be compared and interpolated. Interpolated means to insert. They must be inserted one to another and compared one with another and to get the big picture. But there's many of them. It's a very, very big task. And it doesn't just go on the surface of scripture, because you can use typology as well. I'm sure you understand what I mean by typology. The shadows and types. It says that the tabernacle in the wilderness was a shadow and type of things. It speaks of things being a shadow and type of things to come. The interpretive challenges, then, a lot of them. The timing with Israel. If the church is to become one new man, and as scriptures say that we're grafted in, and it's only this one new man, those that know Christ, those that come to Christ, whether they're Jew or Gentile, that come together as one new man, that they are the seed of Abraham that was being prophesied. That we are part of that seed, then where does all that fit? People say, well, in that case, they must go up together. I'll just show that for a minute. I think it's Ephesians 2:15 and 16 says, to create in himself one new man from the two, that he might reconcile them both to God in one body through the cross. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Another point. It's confusing the Antichrist government with Jacob's trouble and other events. The scriptures speak of Jacob's trouble. And very easy to see how you can overlay that, because there are some scriptures that almost indicate it's sort of parallel with the tribulation, but I don't believe it is if you read them carefully and again. Jacob's trouble must be a problem before the Antichrist arises, because otherwise why were they going to strike a peace deal with such a man? Well, that's my proposition. So I'm saying don't automatically correlate Jacob's trouble with the tribulation period. Then secondly, about the tribulation period, another interpretive challenge is identifying the Great Tribulation with the entire Antichrist rule. There's tribulation and there's Great Tribulation. I've got a slide to talk about that in a moment. The Antichrist rule over Israel begins as a peace treaty. And it does say in Daniel 9, that that's halfway through. Identifying the Great Tribulation then with the entire Antichrist rule is something we get sucked into, but it's not accurate, I believe, if you re-examine this. The next thing I've got noted here is that everybody talks about a 7-year period. And you can understand why, because we speak of sevens. 77s are for your people. We know that the sevens are referring to years. And also the scriptures speak about 1260 days at the beginning of the tribulation. It talks about 1260 days at the end of the tribulation. That's 3.5 years, plus 3.5 years is 7 years. So it's easy to say why we fall straight into this believing the 7 years is definitive. Yet how do you correlate that with chapter 8? I've forgotten the scripture reference. I must have it later, I'm sure, somewhere. Because the duration of the Antichrist rule over Jerusalem is said in the book of Daniel to be for 2,300 days. In one place in chapter 8 it says, "And for how long will this be, Lord, from the trampling down to whatever?" And he says, "It shall be for 2,300 evenings and mornings." Wow. Evenings and mornings, mostly translated days, but it also refers to the sacrifices, doesn't it? The evening and morning sacrifice. But the evenings, the day starts in the evening as far as Israel is concerned. And then we've got the interpretation of the timeline in Revelation, a thorny subject, again, that is mostly avoided. And yet, it's there for a purpose. There's a blessing promised on the study of that book. It's the only book which is prefaced and terminated with the promise of a blessing by reading. And I found it a great blessing. Especially then, the trouble that we have in reading the timeline in Revelation would be the timing of the trumpets. I'm going to refer back to that. There's also a confusion over the end of the age, and then things where it says, "Then comes the end." Well, the end of what? The end of the age, or the end of all things? Mm-hmm. Mark referred to that earlier in Peter's writings, that he goes straight to the end of the earth, you know, being rolled up into a fireball or whatever it is. Well, we know bits of science how that seems to work on stars. It's obviously going to be the earth's ultimate goal. But, you know, God will have accomplished his purposes within that. So there's a confusion when we talk about the end. The end of what? And all these confusions mask how people come to read the timing of the rapture. So let's have a quick look at why people consider the pre-tribulation rapture. Now, I'm not saying I've got a definitive on this, and if you wanted to, please add to it, those of you that got the pre-trib view. But the pre-tribulation views are well established They were popularized by John Darby, but predating him. Big churches in the USA are so attached to this view that those who hold an alternative position often get a hostile reaction. So why the pre? Well, things like Abraham is typology here. Abraham pleaded with God for Sodom, and God would not have poured out his judgment if 10 righteous could have been found. So it's saying that, you know, God's not going to pour out his wrath, his judgment, until the righteous are out of the way. That's the parallel. Similarly with Lot, hurry and escape there, for I cannot do anything. He's speaking concerning the destruction of Sodom there. Until you arrive there. This is Genesis 19, verse 22. But on the day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all, on the day that Lot went out. And then it goes on, Jesus said then, this was in Luke 17:29, even so it will be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. So we've got a pretty accurate statement there that it's not going to be for God's righteous to be caught in that. That does seem to be very clear in the parallels. They're there for a reason. That's why they are there. That's why Jesus said, even so it will be like that when the Son of Man is revealed. Enoch was raptured 660 years before the flood. Methuselah died 7 days before the flood. And Jesus said, as in the days of Noah, so also will be the coming of the Son of Man. So you see, you've got all these parallels and more. So there's a good case to go down the pre-tribulation view if you don't think more deeply into some of these timing problems with Revelation and other issues.
Just want to mention there about the misuse of the word tribulation there, because that word tends to be in the 7-year block of time.
Yep.
And that leads to problems.
It does. Have I got it on here? Oh, you mean just generally? Indeed. This is what I was saying, really, that the tribulation and the great tribulation get mixed up. And I've got a slide, so I'll just fill that onto the slide. Okay. Post-tribulation rapture. Post-tribulation appears to derive from the Olivet Discourse. And by interpret, that's when Jesus on the Mount of Olives gave his end times report. And by interpreting the Revelation timeline on a sequential chapter basis. You know, Revelation isn't sequential. Revelation goes almost to something nasty at the end and then stops as an interlude and starts again. And then it comes to the same point, it seems almost, but a bit more detail this time. And then stops and then does another interlude and then it does it again. It keeps doing it. I'll refer to that on another slide. So the post position, so we've so far looked at the pre, the mid, and now the post. Sorry, the post, we're going to look at the mid, aren't we? Post position, Matthew 24, 29 to 31. Immediately after the tribulation, all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and he'll send his angels with the sound of a trump, but they'll gather together his elect. This connects with, this was Jesus in his Olivet Discourse, and it connects with 1 Corinthians 15:51, and the seven trumpets of Revelation. Daniel 12, referring to the one new man. And there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation. This is the post position, remember. Such as there never was as a nation, even to that time. And at that time, your people shall be delivered. Speaking to the Jewish people. Everyone who's found written in the book goes a bit further. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. I think it's a mistake when you look at scriptures like this. This is a personal view. I'm just giving you my personal view here. I think it's a mistake when you look at scriptures like this to say, well, that was spoken to the Jewish people, Daniel's people, and so that's where you have to keep it. Because actually, when you go into everyone who is found written in the book, and many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth, it's like this whole business of speaking about Jesus, the Messiah, coming, and not saying that he comes once and twice. It reads right across to the end, in one instant. And I think there's a lot of that in the way that whole of the prophetic scriptures are written. And by sort of focusing and saying, well, that was written to the Jews, that was written to the Gentiles, I think we miss a lot. That isn't how God thinks. God's a holistic thinker. He's a big picture as well as all the detail. The post, here we are, Revelation 6, 9 to 11, the cry of the martyrs. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge your blood on those who dwell on the earth? Then a white robe was given to each of them, and it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer, until both the number of their fellow servants and their brethren who would be killed as they were was completed. So you see, it is speaking about martyrdom there. And we're in Revelation 6. You've got to put the whole jigsaw together, though, to really get a context on it. So I just draw it to attention that it does say, after the fifth seal, those who've been slain have got to wait a bit longer because the numbers aren't complete. That was in the midst of this Revelation story. Revelation 7, 13 to 14, 7, 13, 14 speaks of the sixth seal preceding the trumpets. One of the elders answered, saying to me, who are these arrayed in white robes, and where did they come from? So this is further in scripture. And I said to him, sir, you know. So he said to me, these are the ones who come out of the great tribulation and washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. So you can see where the post position comes from, can't you? I mean, I'll just go over that again. Who are these, Lord? And he says, these are the ones who come out of the great tribulation, washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. And yet it's in the wake of this martyrdom description. And it's a bit almost difficult not to connect those. So you can see where the post position comes from. What about the mid-trib? The mid-trib or pre-wrath views. There are two. I'm going to stick to mid-trib as a description, but there are actually two angles. People that go for mid-trib because there's a 1260 days and 1260 days making seven, and there's that midpoint making 7 years. Or there's the pre-wrath position, which is a bit different, because wherever wrath comes, it means the rapture comes before that. And it could be any time before that. So it's less specific. I think Mark's a pre-wrath man at the moment. Ish. These views seem to have more popular support. I did an internet search to see what people thought in general. And I found ever such a lot about the mid-trib or pre-wrath position, and not much about the others. Whether that's because the internet searches I do guide Google to tell me what I want to hear, I don't know. But it appears as if you do a Google search within the UK, you'll see a lot about this position rather than the others, with good foundational reasons. Not always, but there are two versions then, similar in broad terms, the middle of the assumed 7 years and the pre-wrath, given that God's wrath comes during or at the end of the assumed tribulation period. And then it says in Thessalonians, for God did appoint us to wrath, and in Romans, we shall be saved from wrath through him. And then in the world, you will have tribulation. So we've got to be careful about this tribulation. Let's just consider this. It says that in the world, we will have tribulation. In John 16:33, and other places. For in those days there'll be tribulation such as not been since the beginning of creation, Jesus said. Well, just bear those things in mind for a minute. Daniel's prophecies, this is to do with the tribulation versus the great tribulation. Daniel's prophecies concern empires, and in particular, the final empire before Christ's rule on earth. A global government led by the Antichrist, who will be a totalitarian dictator possessed by Satan himself. You know, scriptures are pretty clear about that. Then the tribulation period. The tribulation period is associated with this governmental period, but its grip will most likely be progressive, although admittedly it can be fast with modern technology. In other words, as soon as the peace treaty is signed and the Antichrist takes his place, there's inevitably an outworking of events. And then we speak of the Great Tribulation. Or Jesus speaks of it in Matthew 24:21, but it's mentioned only two other times in Revelation. It has a clear demarcation. Daniel 12:11 says it will last 1290 days, or 3.5 years and a bit. Obviously the last part of the Antichrist rule. If the treading down is 2,300 evenings and mornings, or that's 6 1/3 years, by the way, it encroaches seven-year periods. It just isn't the whole of the 7 years. And God's wrath is dispensed on earth, but during this time, Scripture is clear about that. And then there's the abomination of desolation. I believe that, as Jesus said about, Jesus spoke of the abomination of desolation as spoken of by Daniel. It says in brackets, let the reader understand. The reader would have to understand it because that abomination had already taken place in history with one of the Grecian Empire's successors, Antiochus IV, when he poured pig stew over the altar, desecrated the altar in the temple. But Jesus was saying, it will last, what is it? Obviously, last, where am I? The abomination. Anyway, Jesus said, let the reader understand. So, this is a point now about interpreting scriptures in the context of prophecy of the return of Jesus. Let me finish with this great tribulation first. Matthew 24:21, for then it shall be great tribulation such as wasn't since the beginning of the world to this time, no nor ever shall be. Revelation 22:22, behold, I'll cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And Revelation 7:14, these are they which came out of the great tribulation and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Those are the only mentions of the great tribulation, but they're significant. Scriptures that are often overlooked. Daniel 8:13-14, I'm just picking out from 8. How long will it take for the vision to be fulfilled? The vision concerning the daily sacrifice? The rebellion that causes desolation? Or spoken of by Daniel, you see. And surrender of the sanctuary and of the host that will be trampled underfoot. He said to me, it'll take 2,300 evenings and mornings. Then the sanctuary will be reconsecrated. Daniel 9:27, the 70 weeks prophecy, the last part of it says, then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. But in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering, and on the wing of abominations shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation which is determined is poured out on the desolate. That's hard to understand, isn't it? But what it's saying, if you were to study it carefully and compare scripture and history, what it's saying is the wing of abominations. It's the wing of the temple where the abominations of desolation are carried out. And it's in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. So it indicates that there'll be temple worship reinstated. It indicates that there will be a third temple, the desire of the Jewish faithful. I think it's more than likely that every stone is cut and stored away for a quick Lego job. Certainly, all the garments and the utensils have been made and are in store at the Temple Institute, and you can see some of them on display at the Temple Institute in Jerusalem. One of my favourite must-goes every time I go to Jerusalem. Hallelujah. And so, why would it not be? Jesus, his temple was destroyed. You know, when Jesus said about this temple will be destroyed, and on the third day it will be resurrected, built again or something, he was speaking about this temple, his body. They didn't get it at the time. But if his temple was destroyed but is going to be built again, all the natural has to work alongside the spiritual. The natural is an outworking of the story of the spiritual from beginning to end. It doesn't just stop because Jesus came to the cross. The whole story is worked out from beginning to end, including the fact there'll be a rebuilt temple. This is me speaking. This is me reading scriptures and speaking about the typology logic when you put it together. And there will be a rebuilding of the third temple. And this will probably be part of some peace deal. And when it's built, he'll say, right, out of the way, my image go in there. And I want everybody to bow to it, or else off with their heads. Or something. He'll take over the position of God. That's what the implications are. Now that's me speaking. I'm going now beyond scripture, but scripture says things that cannot be answered very well if you don't take that position, I believe. This is why I say scriptures have to be interpolated. Matthew 24:15 says, therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, brackets, whoever reads, let him understand. And that's the abomination which brings desolation. So what does it mean if it's going to bring desolation? Surely it means that that's when God says enough's enough. He's put up with all the things of the Jews going their own way and putting him to the cross. But they've never actually done anything but been looking for their Messiah. They've never actually accepted another Messiah. And here we are taking on this foul God. Well, that's the desolation, I believe. That's me speaking. How that affects the rest of it is secondary. The scriptures overlook then Daniel 11 with Antioch Epiphanes. And I'm saying especially the last verses 36 to 45. Antioch Epiphanes is a type of Antichrist and is fulfilled to the letter in history from verse 1 of chapter 11 to verse 35. But verse 35 makes a transition to the actual Antichrist. Verses 36 to 45 are not fulfilled in history. There has to be a fulfillment. There are therefore two possibilities that I can see. Either the last Antichrist, the final Antichrist, carries out verses 36 to 45, or actually reenacts verse 1 to 45. I believe that's the more likely. Because Antiochus Epiphanes was given so that we might know what we see when it's happening. You can't necessarily forecast how and when it's going to happen. But once it unfolds before your eyes, you've got no excuse for not knowing what you're seeing. If we understand these things in Scripture, can you now see why it's important to get to grips with Scripture? Because if it's in our time, we may be the ones that could miss it. It would be so subtle. Let me tell you something, if I may, about the spirit of Antichrist. it is extremely powerful. There's no one here that could withstand it, except for the Spirit of God being strong within us. It will delude anyone who's not strong in the Spirit of God. It's a great delusion. How do I know? I worked once for an Israeli ministry where the spirit of Antichrist took over in certain places. By golly, it was by the mercy of God I saw it for what it was. By the mercy of God. Even the very elect shall be... What was it?
Deceived.
If it were possible. It must be possible, else he wouldn't say that. But by staying strong in Jesus and his word and searching his scriptures. But you see, scripture is of no private interpretation. I wouldn't dare be dogmatic about what I'm saying. You know, I always preface my prayers to the Lord before these things, that the Lord causes people to hear the things that he has value for them and for the others to wash away. And Lord, that is my prayer. That the things, Lord, that are good in your sight, for each individual they'll be different as well, I'm sure. That, Lord, you cause those things. And the things that I don't say, Lord, for you by your Spirit to speak into hearts. But I would urge you to share on this. Don't just go into your own little box because everybody can't agree. My old mentor, Danny McVicker, taught me how to argue. And Shirley said to him one day, "Why are you always thumping the table at him, Danny, and arguing with him over scripture?" He says, "Well, I believe most of what he's saying, Shirley, but he's got to learn to prove it." That's the health that needs to be. That's what the Jews do. You know, they don't fall out about it. They have a good old argument and they love each other even more for it. Hallelujah. Now, Daniel 12, at the end to the sacrifice and offering. A time of trouble, deliverance and resurrection, you see. It says in Daniel 12 that it's a time of trouble. Daniel 12 sums things up to the end, really. A time of trouble, a time of deliverance and restoration. Focused on Israel at the time. The book of Daniel is then sealed until the time of the end. Knowledge shall increase and many will run to and fro. Well, it sounds like the day's wearing. Verse 11 says, "And from the time that the daily sacrifice is taken away and the abomination of desolation is set up, there'll be 1,290 days. So from the time of all that being set up, there's only going to be 1,290 days and then the end. Well, what end? The return of the Lord. I've got a lot of scriptures here, and you won't see them, but you can probably see that the ones on the left say the first 3.5 years, and the ones on the right say the second 3.5 years. And as you can see, instead of one directly following another, there's an overlap. What am I suggesting? I'm suggesting that if the total period is only 2,300, evenings and mornings, it has to overlap. The things that it says about the second period begin before the first period has closed. And I'm sorry if you can't see that, and I don't think it justifies me reading them all out. But you've got Daniel on the left, you've got Daniel 7:25, the one before the first period. It says, "He shall speak great words." This is speaking of the Antichrist. "Against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they'll be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time," which is your 3.5 years. And then the second's got a lot of references. I'm going to bypass them. Scriptures that are often overlooked then, Revelation 8 and the trumpets. The dispensation of God's wrath is delayed at the seventh seal. It says in 8:1, "When he opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour." And then another observation. The trumpets sound after this ending with the bowls of wrath. So you see, the trumpets are held up, and within the trumpets come seven last plagues. So, Revelation 16, the seven last plagues, also known as bowl judgments, bowls of wrath. Verse 1 says, I heard a loud voice from the temple saying to the seven angels, go and pour out the bowls of wrath of God upon the earth. So, that's the bit where the ultimate end comes, where things get so bad that we don't need to be around, thank you. Look at this little chart. It's like a target with a bullseye in the middle and five rings, including the bullseye. And the outer ring, I've said, is the church age. So we start off with the prophetic on the big scale, the church age. It's often thought, in dispensational terms, that the seven churches of Revelation represent seven periods of the church, and it's of the church in general in the world and its characteristics. And that we're in the Laodicean age, which is the lukewarm church in this age. Mm-hmm. That's often thought in dispensational terms. If you take that, then the big picture is what God has painted, and then within that, we come up closer. We come into the last days. I believe the last days could be figured more or less by the world wars. You know, the horsemen go out, the horsemen of the apocalypse and so on. And the world wars, after all, it's the first time they were called world wars. And they were strategic in prophetic terms. They were strategic because it's often said that they prepared the people for the land. And without the world wars, how would God have forged the resurrection of the land of Israel? Mm-hmm. And put it back together and pressed his people back into the land. Mm-hmm. Hard preaching, but it's hard to deny. The First World War prepared the land for the people. Mm-hmm. The Second World War prepared the people for the land. And then the trumpets sound. That's the next movement within the seals, which is the final warnings. And there's thunders, seven thunders, which are not revealed. And then the seven last plagues, the bowls of wrath. And that's really leading up to the return of the Lord. So the last phase of each period is expanded. I've said this earlier. We talk about things in the early stages of Revelation, and it almost comes to the nasty bit, but then it stops. You see, that's God's heart. He warns, and he warns, and he warns, and it even emphasizes that in the seven bowls of wrath, because it says, and they still cursed God. And they still did not repent. And then it says, and they cursed God and did not repent. It gets worse. But God all the time withholds. He brings it to a close conclusion and then he holds back. And so don't expect, when everything looks as if it's going to happen, this is it. It's more likely that it's another warning. I don't know whether any of you read The Trumpet Sounds for Britain. Who was it wrote it? Gardner. Gardner. The Trumpet Sounds for Britain. Anyway. So here's another chart overlaying those two periods, and what it's actually saying is that